When the traffic is moving, I really enjoy driving. I like to drive. I'm not a very good passenger, okay? Some of you, I've ridden with you before. I'm not a good passenger, but I like to drive, and I like to be on a highway. I like to have multiple lanes around me. I like the highway because there's no stop signs. There's no intersections. It's just wonderful open road. But I think you can also see in your mind those times when you're on the highway and you find yourself in a long string of cars. It seems as if everyone is traveling at the same rate of speed, and we're just in this long string, this long train of cars. And at the head of this string of cars, it's almost someone setting the pace, and the rest of us are just following along. And when the lead car pulls into the left lane to pass someone, you look behind you, everyone's pulling into the left lane. We pass that slow individual, then a lead car back into the right lane, and everyone appropriately follows. We all follow. You see, from my perspective, in mid-string, from my perspective in mid-parade, I'm following the vehicle in front of me. I'm following the vehicle in front of me, but at the very same time, I'm leading all the cars behind me. So I'm following the person in front of me, but at the same point in time, I'm leading the people behind me. I'm leading while following. Say that with me. I'm leading while following. I'm following while leading. And that's exactly where Paul calls Timothy to be. Not on an open highway, not in a string of cars, but Paul is speaking to Timothy this morning. Timothy, a young pastor. And Paul is reminding Timothy that he needs to lead the Ephesian congregation well. Timothy, you need to lead God's people well. You need to lead them in the direction of Jesus. But Timothy, while you are leading people in the direction of Jesus, Paul says, you also have to follow me. It's important that while you're leading others towards Jesus, you yourself must be following a mature brother or a mature sister in Christ. If you're going to lead well, you need to follow a faithful, mature believer well. Leading while following. Say it with me again. Leading while following. And that's what Paul takes the opportunity to explain in these few verses. Listen with me to the word of God. But understand, verse 10, you, however, have followed my teaching, my conduct, my aim in life, my faith, my patience, my love, my steadfastness, my persecutions and sufferings that happened to me at Antioch, at Iconium, and at Lystra, which persecutions I endured. Yet from them all the Lord rescued me. Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evil people and imposters will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings. We just sang about those ancient words. The sacred writings which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. Church, if we're going to lead people well in the direction of Jesus, we need to follow well the life of a mature, faithful believer. How does this whole process work? Well, Paul starts out by telling Timothy to keep an eye on his, number one, conduct. Say that with me, his conduct. Paul invites Timothy to look at Paul's mature, faithful life in terms of how he lives. Paul says, I want you to see how I conduct myself. I want you to listen to how I conduct myself, how I interact, how I do life in every single season, in every single space, in every single conversation, all the time. Timothy, I want you to follow me and keep an eye on my conduct. He says it this way, looking down at verse 10 with me. He says, you, however, you, Timothy, have followed my teaching, my what? My conduct. My aim in life, my faith, my patience, my love, my steadfastness, my persecutions and sufferings that happened to me at Antioch, at Iconium, and at Lystra, which persecutions I endured. So Paul says to Timothy, I want you to study my life. Timothy, I want you to look at my life in full. I want you to review the entire thing. Timothy, nothing is off limits. Ask me anything you want to. Watch me. Hang out with me all day long. Hang out with me during the week. Hang out with me on the weekend. Timothy, I want you to study and review my life in full, my conduct, my lifestyle. And I pray that this helps to keep you going in the right direction. And Timothy, I pray that this is a source of encouragement for you. Wow. So I just got to pause right there a minute. How many of us would dare, or how many of us are at a place where we would say to someone, I want you to follow me all the time and study my life. I want you to follow me all the time and I want you to see how I conduct myself. Nothing's off limits. How many of us would be ready to have someone studying us, following us that closely, right? They get to listen to everything we say. They get to see everything we text, everything we post. They get to eavesdrop in on every conversation. They follow every single footstep. They see all of our reactions, all of our responses. Nothing is off limits. How many of us are that ready to invite someone to see how we conduct ourselves? And yet that's exactly the invitation that Paul gives to Timothy. Folks, we have to acknowledge, I have to acknowledge, the Christian community needs men and women like that, desperately. Within the life of the Christian community, throughout the course and the entirety of the week, we need faithful, mature, not based on age, but maturity based upon depth of spiritual walk. Women and men who have fully surrendered with heart and soul and mind and strength, everything, to following Jesus. The Christian church, the community of Christians, as we do life together, we need such faithful men, faithful women, faithful disciples that we can watch and study and see how they conduct themselves. Can we agree with that, church? Amen? We need that. That's how discipleship happens. And so Paul invites Timothy. He says, okay, watch how I conduct myself. Watch how I do life. And as he invites Timothy to see how he conducts himself, it's clear that he's inviting Timothy to listen to what he says, what he teaches, the message of the gospel and scripture that he's making known. He says, Timothy, you've listened to me. You know that I'm not revising the Word of God. I'm not editing the Word of God. I'm not skipping anything from the Word of God. I consistently present what God says without tweaking it. And he also says, I want you to see how I conduct myself in terms of the most important thing that I do is make Jesus known. Timothy, I conduct myself in such a way where I am always taking the opportunity to speak of Jesus as Savior and Lord. That's the primary purpose of my life. That's what I'm called to do. That's what I want to do in every single season. And he says, Timothy, I do it in such a way whereby I have an unwavering attitude. I'm going to be consistent in my faith. I'm going to be patient. I'm going to be loving. I'm going to be steadfast. Timothy, I want you to see how I conduct myself. I'm not one of these reactionary, explosive people. I'm patient. I'm loving. I'm steadfast. I'm in this for the long haul by that gift of faith. Timothy, see how I conduct myself? And he says, do you even see how I conduct myself when I was in Galatia? And he lists these three towns. And of course, Timothy knows these three towns because this is Timothy's home province of Galatia. And so these three towns, oh yeah, I know what you're talking about. It'd be like saying Hudsonville, Allendale, Jenison. And Timothy says, oh yeah, I know those places. I know people from there. And Paul says, yeah, I was there. And you know what? It wasn't always very easy. I suffered and I struggled in some of those places, but my conduct never changed. Timothy, my conduct never changed. You could follow me the entire time. You could see what it looks like to be a faithful disciple of Christ. So if we're going to lead others to Jesus, it's important that we have someone to follow who's leading us. You see, if you're pouring your life into others, saying, come here by the power of the Holy Spirit, I want to show you and tell you about Jesus. It's important to have someone that you're following who is pouring into you, a mature, faithful believer. If you're going to lead, you have to follow. Say that with me. If you're going to lead, you have to follow. And as we're faithfully following, now we think about how we lead. And as we lead, Paul says, you're going to face certain cruelty. Say that with me. Certain cruelty. You're going to have some cruel experiences. You're going to have some difficult things. You're going to have some struggles. You could use the word suffering. You could use the word persecution. You know the popular word today? Bullying. Say that with me. Bullying. We have all these programs about bullying. You're not supposed to bully. You're not supposed to be a bully. He says, you know what, Timothy, it's not always going to be easy. There's going to be cruelty. Down there, verse 12 again, it says, indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evil people and imposters will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. All who desire to live a godly life will be persecuted. I've heard from a number of folks over time, and they say, you know what, I'm just blessed. You know, I've never had anybody bully me for my faith. I've never had anything cruel happen. I've never had to suffer for my faith. I've never been persecuted. I've never had anyone come against me. I've not been limited in any way. You know, man, I've never had that experience before. Verse 12, indeed, all, say it with me, indeed, all All who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. A couple weeks ago, I read a quote from a pastor looking at this verse, thinking about cruelty, thinking about bullying, thinking about suffering. And this is what he said. Self-centered Christians who serve the Lord half-heartedly seldom have to pay a price for their faith. They are of little threat to Satan's work because they are of little benefit to Christ's work. Ouch. Can you say that with me? Ouch. Yeah, that hurts. Whew. Self-centered Christians who serve the Lord half-heartedly seldom have to pay a price for their faith. They're of little threat to Satan's work because they are of little benefit to Christ. Wow. You know what? You don't like to hear that. I don't like to say that. But it smacks me right between the eyes. Leading others well requires that all live a godly life in every single aspect and sphere without fear of what the world's going to do to us. If they're going to be cruel, let them be cruel. If they're going to be bullish, let them be bullish. If we're going to lose something, hey, you know what? They cannot take away our eternal faith in Jesus Christ. They cannot take away the eternal significance of our salvation. Amen? So bring it on. We're not called to bunker living. We are called to live out our faith everywhere all the time. And if it gets cruel, let it get cruel. Jesus said it's going to. In John 15, just listen to this. John 15, verses 18 and 19, Jesus is speaking. And he says, if the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. The world hated Jesus. Jesus said, if they hate me, they're going to hate you. Jesus says, if they were cruel to me, yeah, that's cruel. Jesus says, if they were cruel to me, if they were bullish to me, if I suffered under their hands, if I was persecuted because of them, Jesus said, if they did all of that to me, we should expect it. If we are going to lead others well towards Jesus, we need to be willing to face the cruelty, the criticism, the bullies, the restrictions. We need to be willing to endure it all. Amen, church? Let's try that again. Amen, church? We need to be willing to suffer for the one who suffered for us. Amen, church? Amen. This is not bunker living. It's not. If we're going to lead others well to Jesus, we also have to continue. Say that with me. Continue. Continue to follow those ancient words. Continue to follow the timeless truth of Scripture. Continue without revision. Continue without apology. Continue without edit. Continue without apprehension. Continue without a spirit of fear. We need to continue to believe in, we need to continue to present God's word for what it says. Continue. At verse 14, it says, but as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you've been acquainted with the sacred writings, the ancient words, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Paul says to Timothy, don't quit early. You haven't compromised. Don't start compromising now. Timothy, you are a steward of the holy word of God. And you need to continue to share what it says. Timothy, there is no new knowledge. Timothy, there is no new information. Timothy, you don't have to figure out how worldly contemporary philosophy can fit into this. Timothy, don't get sucked into all of these mindless debates and preferences or, I think now that. No, Timothy, don't do that. Continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed. Paul says, Timothy, you know those who shared this word with you. You can trust them. Paul was one of them, used by God to impart this singular word of truth. He says, Timothy, continue to share what you believe from the word of God. He says, you can trust your grandma. You can trust your mom. You can trust Eunice. You can trust Lois. Why would your grandmother lie to you? Why would your mom lie to you? They have no reason to lie to you. How would you think you now know something better than them? They loved you enough to tell you the truth, to share with you what God's word says. I think that's part of God's command in honoring your mother and your father. Trust what you've learned from them regarding the word of God. Continue in it without doubt. Because Timothy, if you're going to lead people well towards Jesus, that is the direction that God's word is going in. It contains all that we need to know for our salvation that is in Jesus Christ alone, by faith, by grace. Amen, church? Continue. Now's not the time to stall out. Thank you for listening faithfully. One more. We need to faithfully follow a mature. They have depth. They have character. They have conduct that's worth following. We need to be willing to lead facing cruelty, whatever bullish antics the world throws at us. We need to continue in the truth of God's word without compromise. Finally, fourthly, lastly, we need to be complete. Say that with me. Be complete. Faithful leaders submit to the authority of Scripture with the singular desire of being made complete in it, being made competent, being made capable of handling it. That means every single experience of life, every conversation of life, every question that is asked, every choice that must be made, every response that we have opportunity to give, it must all be found in the Word of God. Isn't it curious how oftentimes we try to answer a question, but it's based on how we feel. It's based on worldly things. It's based on creature comforts. It's based on what we have in our possession. How often do we respond to situations? How often do we respond to people? How often do we answer questions based upon Scripture? Boy, here's what I'm working on. How often do we lovingly discipline our children with the truth of God versus just getting plain mad? Whew. Boy, there's a lot of room for sanctification in my life there. Amen, church? If you're going to lead people well to Jesus, you need to be complete in the Word of God. You need to be competent. You need to be capable. You need to be able to handle it well. All Scripture is breathed out by God, verse 16 says, and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be what? Complete, equipped for every good work. Breathed out by God, for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness. The Word of God is complete in that everything we need to know is contained there within. The question is, how much of that do we know? How much of that do I know? How complete am I? How competent am I? How capable am I? How much time do I spend in this Word? Not for work, but for my walk. How much effort goes into my study of God's holy word? How complete, how full, how competent, how capable am I? You know, we always learn what we want to know. Say that with me. We always learn what we want to know. And we know a lot. We've learned a lot, right? We learn what we want to know. A lot of times, we will go to a device. We want to know something about someone. And so we follow them, we scroll through, we look at pictures, we go to another website, we go to another place. And how many of you have ever spent longer than an hour at a time on social media? I don't want to use the word liar. Let's just let that be a rhetorical question, right? See, we learn what we want to know. We can learn. The question is, what do we want to learn? Do we want to be complete, competent, and capable in the Word of God? We practice what we want to improve. We're not afraid of practice. We know that practice increases our knowledge. We know that practice increases our skills. We know that practice increases our level of game. We're not afraid of practice. We'll spend hours. We'll travel the distance. We'll do the work. We'll do the preparatory work in between. We practice because we want to get better. Do we practice so that we be complete and competent and capable in the Word of God? How many of you have ever had to fix something around the house and you said, I'm going to YouTube it? Hey, even I changed out a heating element in an oven. Ooh. Then I hurried up and sold the house, right? No. Before you want to do something nowadays, before you do anything, you know what? You go and you YouTube it. I want to see how it's done. I want to do it the right way the first time. I want to be complete. I want to be competent. I want to be capable. Do you? Do I? Complete, competent, and capable to do all that God has prepared for us in advance. Equipped for every good work. How complete are we? If we're going to lead people well to Jesus, we have to be complete in His Word. So number one this morning, who are you following? Who is of a spiritual maturity? Who is of a spiritual depth? Remember, it's not based on age. It's based on their pursuit of Jesus. You see how their head and their heart and their soul, their mind, all of their strength is in the game for Jesus. Who are you following? You got to have somebody to follow. You're watching their conduct. Number two, stop hanging out in the bunker and be willing to face the bullish cruelty that comes to all of those who live out a godly life in full. Stop hanging out in the bunker. Stop trying to avoid. For some of us, we need to find a way to continue. Oh, we're starting to compromise. Ooh, we're starting to look at some areas in Scripture and saying, I don't know if I believe that anymore. You know, I've been reading some other stuff. I've been seeing some other things. I've been listening to somebody on YouTube. Whoop! There are some of us who need to get back to center again. And we need to continue. And we need to trust those who have faithfully in the past shared with us the Word of God. Finally, last, be complete, competent, and capable in the Word of God. Chase after the Word of God for knowledge and truth more than you chase after anything else in this world. Can you say amen, church? Amen. Because there's a whole lot of folks who need to be led to Jesus Christ alone. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, thank you for the opportunity to lead. Thank you for the opportunity to follow. Thank you for the privilege of making known the gospel of Jesus Christ and how we think and how we speak and how we listen and how we live. And Father God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, help us to do it well. Help people not to see us, but help folks to see Jesus and to lay it all down in pursuit of him alone. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.